As I hold your broken body and drink your bitter cup, help me realize the depth of your redeeming love. And for all the sin in me, any sin at all, forgive me. Forgive me. Through the constant struggle that never seems to cease, as in life so is the cross, it too was bittersweet. As I receive the sacrament, a holy mystery, I'm amazed you're sharing it with me. You were crushed, you were bruised, you were scorned. Here am I with nothing left but praise for you, praise for you. As I hold your broken body and drink your bitter cup, help me realize the depth of your redeeming love. And for all the sin in me, any sin at all, forgive me. Forgive me. Forgive me.
Thank you so much, David. Turn in your Bibles to Proverbs chapter 24. There is nothing, I think, in our lives that convinces us of our need for wisdom more than being responsible for another life. I remember when Henry was born. Henry was born at 35 weeks, and they had to induce labor because of there were some challenges for Sarah's health, and she was threatened. And so our doctor said, we went to go see him on a Monday. He said, "We're having this baby tomorrow." And Henry was born, like I say, at 35 weeks, and when he was born, he did not have a swallowing reflex. He was healthy, but they said that usually doesn't come until about week 36. And so for the first week of his life, Henry lived in the NICU and had a feeding tube in his nose. And so finally, I mean, it was almost to the day, he would have been 36 weeks. They said, "We're going to send him home with you, but before we send him home with you, you have to do this, torture first." And basically what they wanted us to do is they had this tiny little closet in the hospital there. And I say closet, it had two couches in it and a television, a little mini fridge. And they put Henry in his little plastic bin in the middle of the room. And they said, you know, you all sleep in here with him tonight. And they gave us this formula. They said he has to drink both of these. And if he drinks both of these, then he can go home with you all tomorrow. And if he doesn't, then he'll have to stay here. Well, you just don't sleep under circumstances like that. And so we're there, and Sarah was still really sick at the time. She had lost a whole lot of blood following the birth, and I mean, she was struggling. It was this whole challenge. And again, this is our first night ever in the same room with him, and we're 3 feet away from him, and so every little move he makes, you hear, and you're going, oh, "What's that? What's that? What's going on?" And so I would feed him, and he wouldn't drink all of it. And they had cameras in the room, and so I'd like sneak it in my pocket and go to the bathroom to dump it because I said, "I'm not doing this again." And so basically, they give us this whole night, and I didn't sleep at all. Sarah barely slept. And they said, okay, one more thing. Before you go home tomorrow, we need you to watch some safety videos and take some tests. Like, dude, what? This is my kid. We're paying y'all quite a bit of money. Just let us take him home. And so we watched this. Again, like I say, Sarah is out of it. She's on this medicine. And she's over there going, psst, what's the answer to three? And we're like, we're going to get out of here. And so finally, they gave us permission to have our own child. And we get him in the car. And then it was like, okay, now what? What do we do here? I mean, they had done all these rituals and had made us jump through all these hoops and do all this stuff just to get him out of the hospital. But then we put him in the car. I don't know what to do. And it hit me. I mean, this parenting thing is not just going to come automatically, is it? There are a few things in our life that challenge us. Like being a parent, like being a grandparent, like shaping a life. For many reasons, we see our strengths magnified in our children, but we also see our weaknesses magnified in our children. And the same things we struggle with, we're expected to help them with. And it is a test of our sanctification. It is a test of our love. It's a test of all kinds of things. But we know from the very beginning, right, when before their sin had ever entered into the world, God says to Adam and Eve, be fruitful and multiply. Children and families were God's plan from the very beginning. Not a plan that happened once the world fell, but a plan from before the end that sin entered into the world. And it is so amazing that parents turn to churches so often after a child is born. Why? Because being a parent is such a reminder of your inadequacy. Being a parent is such a reminder of your need for help. So we have to turn to somebody. And throughout the book of Proverbs, Proverbs has helped us with wisdom that we apply to all areas of our life. But tonight, I want us to look at some wisdom it applies to being a parent or a grandparent, to having influence in the life of a child, to having a family. And I want us to glean some understanding of how we can be wise in this endeavor. Look with me in Proverbs 24, in verse 3 and 4. He says this, by wisdom a house is built, and by understanding it is established. By knowledge the rooms are filled with all precious and pleasant riches. How is a house built? It's by wisdom. How does the house become pleasant? It is by wisdom. Right, throughout the book of Proverbs, you see the need for wisdom in the life of the family. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 1, a wise son makes a glad father, but a foolish son is a sorrow to his mother. Proverbs 23, 15 and 16, my son, if your heart is wise, my heart will be will, my heart too will be glad. My inmost being will exult when your lips speak what is right. So what is the greatest joy of a father? It is having a wise son or daughter. What is the goal of parenting? The goal of parenting is to raise wise children. It's not to raise successful kids. It's not to raise happy kids. It's to raise wise kids. And with wisdom, of course, all that other stuff comes. But we have to strive for wisdom. Proverbs chapter 23, verse 24, the father of the righteous will greatly rejoice. He who fathers a wise son will be glad in him. Proverbs 29, verse 3, he who loves wisdom makes his father glad, but a companion of prostitutes squanders his wealth. So again, you see that what strengthens and what upholds a family so much is wisdom. That is, as the parents are wise, they build the house, and that wisdom is reflected to them through their children. And so I just want us to look at Proverbs and think about how to build a home on wisdom. And there's some suggestions I would have. The first thing we need to do is we need to give our children wise priorities. Right? To build a house on wisdom begins with having the right priorities in our home. Proverbs 15 verses 16 and 17 say, better a little with the fear of the Lord than great treasure with turmoil. Better a meal of vegetables where there is love than a fattened ox with hatred. Proverbs chapter 17 verse 1 says, better a dry crust with peace than a house full of feasting with strife. You hear what the writer of Proverbs is saying twice here. Is he's saying, it is better to have a peaceful, it is better to have a happy home than it is to have all kinds of stuff fill that house. It is better to sit around the meal, around the table and enjoy each other's company than it is to have a really fine meal on that table. The writer of Proverbs here is helping us see through wisdom that there are some things in life that matter more than others, and some things will bring us greater joy than others. And if we want to be wise, we have to have the right priorities in life. Too often, there are families that have very little to do with one another, very little relationship with one another, because they are filling their lives with good things instead of the most important things. We as parents need to realize that the priorities we have in our lives are what we teach our children. We pass those along, and so we need to have the right priorities. There's an article I read a few years ago called Building a Happy Home by a professor at, I think he's at Dallas Baptist, his name's Stan Toussaint. And he writes, here's some priorities that every home needs to have. They need to value persons before things. They need to value home before occupation. They need to put partner before children. This one is so vitally important, I think. It drives Henry nuts. Henry, I'll say, I love you. Sarah, I love you, Henry. He'll go, do you love us the same? Nope, not even close. What? I'll say, no, I love Mama way more than I love you. I said, I picked her. God stuck you with me. I said, I love your mom way more than you. When I was a kid, I came by this honestly. I remember coming home. I remember this vividly. I was in third grade, and I said, we had had a fire marshal come and do one of those fire safety classes for the school, and talked about you needed to have a fire safety plan when you get home. And so I came home, and I said, Mom, Dad, because even as a little child, I worried about every little thing. I was like, Mom, Dad, we need to have a fire safety plan. And Dad goes, there's the window. I'm getting your mother out. I said, what? He goes, I can make another one of you. He said, there's only one her. A lot of times, what happens in homes is unintentionally even, children become a wedge between the parents. best case scenario is mom and dad build their whole life around the kids, and then one day Junior moves off to go to college, and there's mom and dad sitting in an empty house with no knowledge of one another. Listen, kids are smart and kids are devious, and they play parents against each other. I see Henry trying to do it, right? There is knowledge, and one parent is a little stricter than the other. One parent's a little softer than the other. You know, you can probably guess who is who. And I see how he does that. But there is no greater security that a parent can give his children than to know dad loves mom and nothing is going to stop that. When I was a kid, I remember so often friends would come to school or come to church and you could just see this despondency in them, this sadness all over them. What's going on? My parents are getting a divorce. I am so grateful. There has never been a day in my life where I worried if my parents would get a divorce. There were times I thought my mom might kill my dad, but never did I think that there would be a divorce. Never did I have to wonder, does dad really love mom? And parents, you need to give your children the security that you love your spouse more than you love them. Because it creates such a sense of comfort for them. You need to put your partner before your children, but you need to put your children before your friends. Again, God has given you a stewardship of your children. You need to prioritize your children. You also need to put your partner before yourself. Again, you cannot rightly love your partner. You cannot rightly love your spouse if you only love them as much as you love you, and certainly if you love them less than you love you. Right? The call to husbands in the Bible is to love your wife like Christ loved the church. And what did Jesus do for the church? He laid down his life for it. Paul says in Ephesians that you need to be sensitive to her needs. Right? There needs to be this priority of your partner, your spouse, over yourself. But there also needs to be a priority of spiritual before material. This is a major thing that families have to work through. How do we prioritize the spiritual in the home? I wish I could give an answer to say, here's exactly how you do it. Right? You have so many things competing for attention these days. You have ball teams and you have all these extracurricular activities and jobs and all this stuff. And those are good things and those are right things. And am I saying you should never miss church for a ball game or for a job? I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that as a parent, it is your job to make sure your children know the priorities. It's your job to make sure they know what's most important in life. And it is imperative that you value the spiritual things in life, that you value eternal things more than you value temporary and material things. Again, going back to those verses that we read, better a little with the fear of the Lord than great treasure with turmoil. Better a meal of vegetables where there is love than a fattened ox with hatred. Again, do you see how serious this is? It's better to have a vegetarian diet and be happy than to eat a really good steak and there not be any fellowship. This is serious. He's saying you need to do this. And so often, parents, meaning well, listen to me, good intentions are not a substitute for right actions. Parents, meaning well, I see dads who work tirelessly so that their kids can have all this stuff. And that's why I would add one thing to this. time needs to be valued over stuff. You know, dads especially, your kids don't need more things, they need more of you. They need more time with you. They need more input from you. They need more affirmation from you. And I know that there are a lot of dads, and they mean well, and they work tirelessly because they want to take their family on the perfect vacation. They want to buy their kids the newest and nicest stuff. Now, I remember in school, I remember wanting certain things that everybody else wore and everybody else thought was cool. I didn't have them. You know what? Now, 20-something years later, my life's okay that I didn't have the pair of Jordans that I wanted. It's okay that I didn't have the video game system that I thought I so desperately needed. It's okay that I got Walmart brand coats instead of Fila jackets. Fila's not even a company anymore, but everybody, when I was in elementary school, you had to have a Fila jacket. We give people stuff, but we do so at the expense of time. And moms and dads, you need to radically think about and deeply look at the priorities in your life. What do people around you seem like it's most important to you? What are you living for? See, here's the thing in chapter 17, verse 1 there, where he says, better a dry crust with peace than a house full of feasting with strife. Literally, the word there that is translated feasting in some is sacrifice. So the picture here is not just a meal. The picture here is a religious ceremony. And what the writer of Proverbs is talking about is you can even prioritize religion, and you can just prioritize looking religious. You can prioritize church over an actual relationship with Christ. You can prioritize going through all the motions and seeing how people see you, and there actually being nothing in your life that you're communicating to your children in terms of your priorities with God. What you communicate to them is that religion is important when other people see and other people pay attention and other people take notice. We need to give our children wise priorities, but secondly, you need to give your children parents who fear God. What can you give your children? You give them a mom and dad that love Jesus more than anything. Right? What have we seen over and over and over in the book of Proverbs? The beginning of wisdom is what? The fear of the Lord. It's this relationship with God. It's this humility that says, God, I want to honor you and I want to serve you. I want to be close to you. I want to have this deep relationship with you. God has ordered the world in wisdom. God made the world and it was perfect. And then sin entered into the world and messed up everything. And you remember, it's so important to note that when in the New Testament, when Paul speaks about the family, when Paul speaks about the relationship of the husband and the wife, when he speaks about the relationship of mothers and fathers and how they relate to one another, Paul never roots it in gender. Paul always roots it in creation. Paul is not saying women should act one way because they're a woman and men should act one way because they're a man. He's saying that they should act this way because this is how God has created them. He's not saying one gender does this better than another, one gender is more superior, inferior in one aspect or another. What Paul is doing, and Paul is saying God ordered creation perfectly, and the way that our families exist ought to mirror that order that God created. We can't help but pay attention to the fact that when sin enters into the world there in Genesis chapter 3, and God talks about the curse of sin, where does sin strike directly? It's in the home. He says that there will be strife between the husband and the wife. She will seek to rule over him. He will seek to dominate her. He says there will be pain in childbirth. Right? God had this perfect plan, be fruitful and multiply, but because sin came, now this act of giving birth, this act of raising children, is going to be a painful and a tough thing. See, sin strikes not close to home, sin strikes at home. Because when God disrupts the family, or when Satan disrupts the family, everything else is disrupted. I mean, you look at our society. Why is our society the way it is? Because the family is so disrupted. Because years ago, we kept making all these compromises about the family, and it has disrupted our entire society. And God has ordered the world in wisdom. But you remember at the very beginning when we looked at Proverbs, I said there's two wisdoms, aren't there? All right, Paul talks about this. There is the wisdom of the world and there is the wisdom of God. There's a worldly wisdom and a godly wisdom. And moms and dads, you are going to parent your family according to one of those two wisdoms. The question you have to ask is, what wisdom are you going to parent your family according to? Because you need to say, what is driving me in life? Is my life being driven by this humble pursuit of God where I'm seeking to honor Him? Right? Do my kids see me loving God? Do I strive? Because here's the thing. The greatest thing I can do to be a dad for Henry is to be a faithful follower of Christ. The closer I am to God, a better husband I'm going to be to Sarah, and a better dad I'm going to be to Henry. The more I love God, and the more deeply I want to serve Him, the more it's going to be seen in every aspect of my life. And only when I'm seeking that, only when I'm striving for that wisdom that comes from this humble pursuit of Him, can I begin to be the parent I need to be. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 3, it shows how foolishness can lead to relationships that are all out of whack. It says, a foolish son is his father's ruin, and a wife's nagging is an endless dripping. Now listen, I realize that the last half of that verse does not come into the politically correct category. But again, what is Proverbs? Proverbs is primarily Solomon speaking to his son. And so he's using a woman here because he's speaking to his son. He's saying, Solomon, this would be bad, but you see, let's look past the verbiage here and understand what he's saying. It. He's saying is that when there's no wisdom in the home is a miserable place to be. When the children are foolish, it's heartbreaking to a dad. It's heartbreaking to a mom. When the husband or the wife, when the mom or the dad, when they are foolish, it's corrosive to the entire family. Right? What we need to do in our homes is not fix the other person. I have to fix me. You do marital counseling, somebody comes in, and what do? Well, here's what they did wrong. You know what I do? I stop them right there. I'm just going to tell you, if you ever want to come see me for marital counseling, I'd love to help you out. But you need to know how I do it. You're not there to talk about what they need to do. You're there to talk about what you need to do. Simple principle of life is you can't change and you can't fix anybody else. We have enough trouble working on ourselves. And the greatest thing that we can do for our families is pursue wisdom and pursue the fear of God in our own life. You know, the times I have most regret as a husband and father is a direct result of a rift in my relationship with God. I'm upset, I'm cranky, I don't trust in Him enough, and so I take that out on my wife and my son. I don't like what's going on, I'm unhappy about something, I'm not content. Take that out on them. The greatest gift we can give our children and our spouse is for us to grow in our relationship with Christ. But the third thing I would say we need to do is we need to train our children in wisdom. It's amazing how we all have things we want to teach our kids. We all have things we want to pass on to our kids. You know, this will show what a nerd I am, but I remember when Henry was in the NICU, and we got to go in there for just a couple hours a day, and I remember sitting by his bedside, and the first thing I ever read to Henry was Genesis chapter 1, followed by The Wasteland by T.S. Eliot. Just because I think he needs to appreciate this one day. I realize as a two-day-old infant, he did not get the intricacies of that work, but that's fine. When Sarah loves art and Sarah loves it, and so what does she, when she and Henry are hanging out, they're usually doing some art projects because she's got stuff that she loves and she's passionate about and she wants to pass on. In Kentucky, every dad's dream is for your kid to play for the University of Kentucky Wildcats. And every dad is convinced, my kid's going to be the one to do it. And so you see all these dads from birth, I'm not exaggerating, putting them in with basketballs and teaching them about all this stuff. They want to pass along that passion. We pass on to our kids what we care about. And we need to pass along wisdom. That needs to be what our heartbeat is. And so how do we do that? A few things I think we can do to train our kids in wisdom. First, you train your kids in wisdom by setting a good example. Proverbs chapter 14, verse 26. In the fear of the Lord, one has a strong confidence, and his children will have a refuge. You make your kid's life better by living a life of wisdom. I had a woman ask me recently. She said, aren't the kids who grow up in Christian homes, shouldn't they just become Christians? Doesn't that make sense? I said, I wish it worked that way. It doesn't, though. I mean, having your kid in church every week is no guarantee that they're going to put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. It's no guarantee that they're going to love Him and follow Him and obey Him. And it's the right thing to do. It's the right thing to pass it along. And it's tough because we so want, if I set a good example, my kids will believe in Christ. There's no promise of that. We can't have control over that. But the best chance for that, I believe, the greatest way for Henry to fall in love with Jesus is for Henry to see me love Jesus. It's for me to set a good example. You know, your children need to see you read the Bible. Your children don't need to see the only time mom or dad open the Bible is when they go to church and others are around. Your children don't just need to hear you pray at dinner time. And they need to hear you pray real prayers. They need to see a passion in you for going to church and serving in church and helping others. You need to set an example for your kids. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 7 says, a righteous person acts with integrity, and his children who come after him will be happy. Listen. You acting with integrity, you acting in wisdom is not a guarantee that your children will follow, but it will still benefit your children. It still benefits your spouse for you to conduct your life with integrity and for you to live your life in wisdom. And so we need to train our children by setting a good example, but also we need to train our children through instruction. You don't just need wise actions, you need wise words. You don't just need to live it out before them. You need to talk about this to them. You need to talk about why you love God. You need to talk about why you read your Bible. See, the Bible is replete with the examples of the Father teaching the Son. Deuteronomy chapter 6, one of the most fundamental verses to the Israelites. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one God. That is immediately followed by Moses telling the fathers, you're to spend your lives, whether you're sitting or rising, laying down, whatever you're doing, you're to spend your life teaching your children this. But parents have relegated the idea of teaching and discipling our children to youth pastors, Sunday school teachers, pastors, churches, whomever. We pass the buck on it. Moms and dads, it is your responsibility. Now, I know that sometimes people look at me and they think, well, Michael, you know, your dad's a pastor. You had it different. Can I tell you something? I do. I have a dad and he's got a PhD in Greek. I have a mom who taught me just as much about Jesus. My mom's got a high school diploma. My mom never took any college. My mom didn't have any of those fancy classes. But she loves the Lord and she wanted her love for the Lord to be contagious to her son. She talked about it. Oh, the lectures. My mom can talk till Jesus comes back. But it wasn't just her actions that she used. It was her words. Moms and dads, you need to instruct your kids through words. Listen, if your kid keeps messing around in an electrical outlet, you're going to tell them, don't do that. And yet parents are very squeamish and parents are very shy to talk about spiritual things with their kids. I think there's two things that are vital. Is you need to know what you're teaching them. And you need to teach kids not just what to think, you need to teach kids how to think. See, the problem is so many parents just say, do this, don't do this, and then the kids go, why? And the parents go, don't question me. One of the things that you're seeing in the national discussion right now homosexuality is the primary factor of people being of accepting the idea that homosexuality is not sinful is because they know somebody who's gay and they think, well, that person's not a bad person, therefore being gay must not be a sin. And the reason that all these people, you look at the trends, younger Christians by and large are accepting homosexuality more and more. Why? Because moms and dads have never taught them why it's wrong. They've just acted like it's gross and we're not going to talk about it. Homosexuality is not wrong because it's different. Homosexuality is not wrong because I think it's gross or I think it's I'm uncomfortable around it or anything like that. Homosexuality is wrong because it goes against God's created order. And anything that goes against God's created order is wrong. But moms and dads are just telling their kids what to think. And then the kids start looking into things for themselves. They start asking questions themselves. And moms and dads have never provided them with a way to use wisdom to think about these moral matters. We don't just need to teach our kids what to do. We need to teach them why we do it. You know, why do you pray? If you're presumably a Christian parent, if most Christian parents, you know, you pray before meals, you pray before bed, whatever it is. If your kid says, Dad, why are we praying? What's the big deal about prayer? What's your answer? Why do you read the Bible? Why do we go to church? Why do we follow Jesus and not Muhammad? See, a lot of times, parents are afraid of those kind of conversations because the parents have not equipped themselves to deal with those kind of conversations. As we teach our kids, as we train our kids, as we instruct our kids, we need to go deeper. We don't need to just say, here's what you ought to think. We need to teach them how to think about the world, how to apply the Bible to all areas of life. We need to teach them not just what to do, but why they should do it, what ought to motivate them as they do that. Because a lot of times what happens is church people raise Pharisee children. You have to be in church because God's going to get you if you're not there. And then all of a sudden the kid goes to college and he sleeps in one Sunday by accident. And he goes, God didn't zap me. Maybe I don't have to go to church. We need to instruct our kids. But then also you need to train your children through correction. You need to set an example, you need to instruct them, but also you need to correct them. Proverbs chapter 23, 13 and 14 says, do not withhold discipline from a youth. If you punish him with a rod, he will not die. Punish him with a rod and you will rescue his life from Sheol. I know kids are cute, but they are sinful. And if we do not deal with sin in the hearts and lives of our children, we are setting them up for destruction. I'm just going to tell you, this may be controversial. I may get a bunch of amens. I don't know. Spanking is biblical. Hey, there you go. Y'all have been in a Walmart recently. Why does Solomon say we ought to spank our kids? Because we love our kids. A lot of times you hear this idea that to spank is an unloving thing. People beat their kids. You ought not spank your kids. Listen, first of all, we should never argue against something because of its abuse. There are people who overeat. That doesn't stop any of us from having a meal. There are people who speed in their cars, yet we drive to church and we drive somewhere else. We can't argue against something because of its abuse. Proverbs says in Proverbs 13, verse 24, whoever spares the rod hates his son, but he who loves him is diligent to discipline him. You see, that word discipline is the key word, isn't it? Because if you'll notice, the word discipline and discipleship are very much the same word. Their root is the same. When I'm disciplining my son, it is not about punishing him because he didn't do what I want. It's not about punishing him because he's not lived up to some standard that I have artificially set for him. It is about helping him be who God wants him to be. And Proverbs says that an effective way to do that is to spank. It is to use the rod. Multiple times it talks about it. You need to set boundaries up for your kids. I remember being with a friend one time and we were talking about rules our parents had for us, and he was like, yeah, my mom and dad, they don't care when I come home. They don't care if I do that. They don't care if I do this. And he's going through stuff. And at first, all of us are really jealous. But the more he kept saying it, the sadder he got. And I realized it wasn't because his mom and dad were just these free spirits. It's because his mom and dad didn't care. Because his mom and dad didn't care how he acted and what he did. And if we don't care enough about our kids to discipline them, Proverbs says they're going to go off into all sorts of wildness. If you love your child, you will set up boundaries in your child's life. Why does God instruct spanking specifically here in Proverbs, though? Again, if you think about it, it makes a lot of sense, because you need to teach your children what sin is. As a parent, it is your responsibility to teach your children what sin is, and you also need to teach them that sin has consequences and that we're accountable for our actions and we're accountable for our decisions. One thing we're going through in our house right now, I didn't mean to do it. Yeah, understand, realize you didn't mean to do it, but carelessness still has consequences. And so we need to discipline our children to help them see But sometimes the sin is so egregious, sometimes the sin is so serious that spanking is necessary. Sin does not just hurt. Sin kills. And for a 5-year-old, a 6-year-old, they do not understand a well-reasoned moral assessment of the universe. Sometimes they just understand, I did this, it hurt, I don't need to do that again. I mean, I remember one of the first times I ever had to spank Henry. Henry was young. I mean, he was just over a year old. And Sarah told him, he wanted something, and Sarah told him no about it, and he said no, and he smacked her in the leg. I said, you come with me. And his grandmother was not happy about that. But this was a non-negotiable for me. You hit my wife, you get a spanking. That applies to everybody, not just Henry. Now, again, we need wisdom in how to apply this. The Bible does not say every time your kid messes up, there needs to be a spanking. Sometimes there needs to be time out. Sometimes there needs to be a talking to. Sometimes there needs to be something taken away with. I firmly believe that the punishment ought to fit the crime. But sometimes the sins are so bad, the sins are so egregious, there is such an open defiance that the most appropriate punishment is a spanking. But we need to apply wisdom in how we do it. Listen, you can't ever spank your children in anger. Don't ever spank them when you're mad. I remember one time I did something, and I don't remember what I did. I just remember my dad sending me to my room, and he said, if I spank you right now, I'm going to do it out of anger, and you don't want me to do that. I'd never been as afraid as I was in my life. But again, when he spanked me, it wasn't about a reaction to something I did. He calmed down, he did it, and he talked to me. Here's what you did wrong. Here's why I'm spanking you. Here's what the punishment is. Here's why it deserves a spanking. I believe that kids grow out of a time where spanking is no longer effective. But especially when they're younger, I feel it's the most effective thing. I think that's what we see in Proverbs. But above it all, what needs to be at the heart of your discipline is love. You're not disciplining because you're mad. You're not disciplining because you didn't like the consequences. You're not disciplining because they did something you don't like. You're disciplining because you love them so much you want what is best for them. And we do what's necessary to see that. Because if we don't discipline our kids, if we just let them run free, it is not only hurtful to society, it's hurtful to them. A kid who has no boundaries is a kid who has never been loved. A kid who has no boundaries is a kid who's dangerous to himself. And my love for my son compels me to set up boundaries in his life and to discipline him out of love when he crosses those boundaries. But what we need to see as parents is the wisest and the greatest thing we can do is to introduce our kids to the perfect Father. Right? It is our job, again, I speak to dads, it is our job as a dad to picture God well to our children. But I mess up. I fail. I have shortcomings. And I am so thankful that I have someone greater than myself to point my son to. I'm so thankful that I have a father who loves perfectly and who disciplines out of love perfectly, a father who desires to help, and a father who ministers. And here in a moment, we're going to be taking the Lord's Supper. And we do so as those who have been adopted into a family. And as it says in the book of Hebrews, Because we've been adopted as his sons, one of the signs of our sonship is that God himself disciplines us. God himself helps us see sin in our life. He helps us see things that we need to fix and things we need to work on. But God in his great love has sent Jesus Christ so that my sins are perfectly and fully forgiven and so that I can be given the gift of his Spirit to help me work on my shortcomings. And so as we prepare to take the Lord's Supper, I just want us to have a moment of reflection before we start here. And I want us to ask God to reveal things that we can work on to be a wise father, a wise mother, a wise grandmother, grandfather, a wise husband, a wise wife, a wise person. How in my relationships with others I can point to Christ and I can honor him. And I want us also to thank God for the love that he shows us as a father that's unconditional. To know that we have been adopted into his family and that through our faith in Jesus Christ, nothing can change that. Let's go to him in prayer. Father, Lord, we pray in this time as we prepare to receive the Lord's Supper, as we are reminded both of the greatness of our sin, that meant Jesus had to die, and the greatness of your grace, that means you sent Jesus to die. Father, we realize that we are sons and daughters because of the work he did. And we pray as Jesus himself taught us to pray by crying out, Father. Realizing that you not only created us, but you love us and you care for us. And Father, you sent your Son so that we can share in all that is his. Lord, I pray that we would be moms and dads and grandmothers and grandfathers and husbands and wives who seek wisdom to be at the very center of our home, who seek to grow every day more like Christ, and in doing so, being a better mother, being a better father, being a better husband, being a better wife, being a better child. Father, I pray that you would gently show us areas we need to work on and grow in. And Father, I also pray that as you do that, we're given the hope and assurance of the reminder of your Spirit to help refine us and purify us, to grow us. And Lord, I pray that as we prepare to receive this supper, Father, I pray that we are focused on how we can make our homes most honoring to you. Because, Father, you gave us our families to be used for you. As David said in Psalms, our children are arrows to be shot into the world. Our marriages are meant to picture your love for us. And so, Father, our homes are not just for our enjoyment, our comfort, but Father, they are at the very heart of the work that you're doing through your church and in this world. So, Father, I pray that we would be wise in stewarding them. Lord, we love you and thank you for your love for us. It's in the name of Christ that we pray. Amen.